Sharpen your pencils, class. We're making rocks. Welcome to another episode of The Gamesmith. In today's episode, we're going to be making hexagonal rock formations known as basalt columns out of dollar store pencils.
These bizarre-looking geological formations have the appearance of tightly packed pencils. They can have 4, 5, and even 6 sides and are known to appear on every continent in the world. This natural phenomenon looks like a geological jigsaw puzzle and only forms in volcanic rock layers. But let's switch to the reason why we're here. We're going to build some freestanding basalt rock scatter terrain. The primary building block we're going to be using are some pencils that I found at the Dollar Tree, but I'm sure you could find them at any dollar store. I bought 6 boxes. These pencils are hexagonal in shape and made of cedar wood, so we can texture them and paint them to look like basalt rock columns. We have 144 pencils to make all the scatter terrain we want to make. We may need more or less depending on the number of terrain features we build. Next, we need to remove all the eraser heads from our hexagonal pencils. Make sure to keep these erasers for some future project. If you have any suggestions for a craft we could make with these erasers, let me know in the comments below. Next, we'll take a few pencils and a piece of a cinder block. Any hard object that has some great texture on it will work best. All we need to do is pound on the pencils to dent the surface of the wood to create wonderful weathered texture. We have to be careful though, we don't want to smash the pencils too much or they'll split. You can still use the broken pieces, but we don't want to have too many of them. You might want to put on some music, or binge your favorite TV show, or watch the Gamesmith playlist, because 144 pencils is going to take a while. Next, we take our textured pencils and a miter box and a dollar store hacksaw and start cutting. We want to create as many different sized pieces as possible. The process is messy as the graphite dust from cutting the pencils spreads everywhere. Once again, this is a long and dirty process given the number of pencils we're going to cut. Now we're going to need a base to mount our terrain on. These different sized natural wood planks are from Dollarama. They'll do the trick. You can use whatever basing material you want, like MDF board, so you can cut it into odd shapes, but I didn't have any at the time when I was filming this video. Next, we can cut a piece of XPS foam to fit onto our base. We do this so we don't have to use as many pencils to build up our rock formation. We can build up the central structure with pink insulation foam instead. The shape doesn't have to be symmetrical or even from XPS foam. We could easily use cardboard, foam blocks, or even an old egg carton. Once we have a number of shapes, we glue them to our base with the hot glue gun. The blocks don't have to be centered or placed in identical positions, since we want our rock formations to look unique. Now we can start adding our pencils to create the illusion of our basalt column formation. The appearance that I'm going for is similar to the Devil's Tower National Monument in Wyoming, USA. If you've seen the movie Close Encounters of the Third Kind, you'll know the type of freestanding, butte-like appearance I want this formation to have. It doesn't really matter where we start gluing our pencils onto our base, but we do need to be mindful of the height of the structure. Don't worry about the placement of that first pencil. It's easy to be intimidated when starting a project like this. After all, we want the build to look cool when we're done, but as long as your first pencil is straight, we'll end up with a great result. Even though we're going to jigsaw these textured pencils next to each other, we don't want them all to fit snugly together. We don't want the terrain to look like we merely grabbed a handful of pencils and glued them into a towering shape. We want some of the pencils to appear as loose columns that time and erosion has forced away from their neighbors. I know that many basalt column formations are the same height because that's how they're formed, but we want to deliberately avoid that uniform look. Also, since we started with taller pencils in the middle, we want to taper to smaller sizes as we move toward the outer edge of the base. We could set up different levels or platforms large enough for 28mm miniatures to easily stand on. We might even consider creating recessed or sunken spaces so we could hide miniatures inside them. We can also place some of the pencil pieces so that they're leaning away from the main structure. We just need to remove the excess glue from the bottom so our base remains flat. Because we're making four of these terrain pieces, we can experiment with different shapes and forms. We could create a more uniform structure on one build and a more decrepit version on another. It's worth mentioning that I've chosen a hot glue gun to assemble our terrain so I can quickly add pieces to our build. I don't think wood glue is the right choice for this build. It takes too long to dry and some of the pieces might shift as the wood glue tends to expand as it cures. We do need to be mindful of the glue wisps that often result from using glue guns. We don't want to leave any long strings behind. We also need to make sure that we don't leave any hot glue bubbles or globs behind that would ruin the illusion of our rock columns. Of course, none of that actually matters on the internal structure of our build. Speaking of which, when it comes to the internal structure, we can leave the central area hollow and use smaller pencil pieces to build up the outside shape. It really comes down to what sizes of pencil pieces we have available. We're more likely to use a greater number of pieces on our first build than we are on our subsequent builds. Also, we shouldn't be adverse to changing the shape of our XPS base in order to fit the pencil pieces. Cutting away some foam to get a better fit is easier than finding a pencil piece that fits exactly the way we want it to. Let's jump ahead to the last few pencils that we'll add to this build. We don't want to fill the entire base of our terrain piece. We want to leave some room to add some flocking or other decorations. We can fill in large gaps with short pencil pieces or fragments so that the area looks like columns have broken away. We can always add more pieces, but it's challenging to remove them. So just remember that less is more. Now that our rock column patch is finished, we can take a quick look at our handiwork. We have some interesting features on this build, like columns that are falling away and areas of broken columns. I'm very happy with how these turned out, and I'm ready to move on. Next, we need to use a black paint to cover our pencils. I'm going to use this Army Painter brand matte black, although any brand of acrylic paint will work fine. Even if we use some inexpensive flat black dollar store paint, we would still get the results we want. Since we're going to be painting these columns with different gray tones to look like rock, we want the base coat to be black. If you're using a spray paint, make sure to follow the directions to get the best results. All painted up, these basalt rock structures look terrific. I'm glad I was able to get the paint down into the tiny little nooks and crannies. There are a few areas that didn't get complete coverage, but we can cover those up later. For the next layer of paint on our rocks, we're going to add a dark gray or graphite color. We use an old brush to dab our dark gray paint around our rocky columns. We want to create a camouflage type pattern, being careful that we don't completely cover the terrain piece. We also don't want to get the dark gray paint into all the cracks and crevices, or it will diminish the deep shadow effect our black undercoat will create. This dark gray will darken because of the black undercoat, so we want to let the paint completely dry before moving on to the next layer. When we add the light gray paint, don't load the brush too much. We want the same camouflage effect as with the dark gray without covering it up. Also, we'll be covering fewer areas with the light gray paint. Once again, being careful not to cover up those dark recesses between the rock columns. There are a variety of different painting techniques you can use to create stone effects. I like this one because it's the easiest while giving the most variety of stone-like textures to our build. Finally, we add white paint as a dry brush to our rock formations. We're going to use a brush with a wide toe so we can get a lot of coverage with minimal paint. Speaking of which, for those of you who are unfamiliar with dry brushing, it's basically a technique for adding a very small amount of paint to your brush, which you then lightly brush on the raised surfaces of our build. Dry brushing has the effect of highlighting minute textures to make them stand out. Or in our case, we're highlighting the areas around the dents and cracks that we added to our pencils earlier. We have a much more detailed video on dry brushing that we could share with you. I'll put the link in the corner for you. Next, we're going to add a basic wash, which is about 70% water and 30% acrylic paint. And we add a few drops of jet-dry dishwasher rinse aid to the mix. If you're new to washes, the jet-dry reduces the surface tension of the water, so it flows better and distributes the color more evenly. For the experienced painters, using a flow improver such as Liquitex Flow Aid from a craft store works much better, but is more expensive. This liquid is going to flow down and fill in all the cracks and pool in the lowest points on our build, which is fine because we're going to be painting the base next. We're going to use this inexpensive dollar store burnt umber to paint the base of our basalt rock formation. Try not to get the paint on the rock formations. and make sure you get the outer lip of the base. It's not necessary to get complete coverage, nor do you need to add a second coat. We're simply adding this brown layer to the base in case any of our turf or flocking has any gaps in it, so it'll look like dirt underneath. Next, we'll add some Aline's Tacky Glue, which is my personal favorite for adding turf and flocking to the base of my terrain builds. The glue is so thick and stays moist for about 20 minutes, and so there's no need to rush in using it. Now we can add some turf to our base for grass effects. I'm a fan of most Woodland Scenic products, and their different colored turfs are among my favorite. This is what I call my discard mix, which is a mixture of all the greenish turfs I've shaken off other projects and put into a single container. We just sprinkle this around the base and up the sides of our basalt rocks where we added our tacky glue. We can even add some more mossy features by adding some tacky glue on the tops and sides of our rocky features. A few spoonfuls of turf will create the feeling of a creeping moss or vine growing up the side of the build. After a few hours, we can shake off the excess turf we used and dump it back into the discard mix container. We can also use a wide brush to remove the excess turf from our build, particularly around the columns. We don't want to be too aggressive with the brush because we don't want to remove the isolated clumps of turf. Next, we're going to add some 50-50 water glue mixture to our base. Then we'll add some Woodland Scenic's blended turf to our base, which is a different color than the dark green turf we used earlier. We pour the 50-50 mixture on the base and spread it around with a brush. This will reinforce the turf that's already on the base against poking and prying fingers, as well as the miniatures that are likely to end up scattered around. Now we can add a few splashes of Earth Blend blended turf, so when the glue dries, we have a multicolored grassy base. We can use some PVA glue to add a few areas of Earth Blended turf to create another color of moss on our rocky columns. We don't want to add too many of these features to our build though. I think the philosophy that less is more applies here. I encourage crafters to use as many different colors as you can, and to match the color palette to the terrain you use at your table. The last embellishment to our base, while the 50-50 glue is still wet, is to add some Army Painter Meadow Flowers. I was able to pick these up on sale at my local hobby store. I can't ask the community enough to please support your local game and hobby stores. These businesses are great places to meet other tabletop gamers, get inspiration for crafts, and pick up specialized supplies like these flower tufts. After the glue and turf is dried, the last step on our build is to add some anti-shine matte varnish to it. I'm using the Army Painter brand to do this, but whatever product you use, please make sure to spray in a well-ventilated area. Also, make sure to follow the instruction on the labels to get the best results from the product. I'm so happy with how these basalt clusters turned out. It's remarkable what some glue and 6 boxes of pencils can be turned into. In hindsight, I think I should have made a few locations where I could safely place some medium-based miniatures higher up on the sides. By drastically changing the colors we used, we could easily create an alien or a fae-like environment that could be used in other games like Star Wars and Warhammer. If you enjoyed this video, please check out some of our other ones. And if you'd like to support us here at The Gamesmith, there's a number of ways you could do that. If you haven't already subscribed, now is a great time. Hit the thumbs up button and give us a like. Ask a question or leave a comment below. Check out our website at thegamesmith.org. Read our free monthly blog and listen to our podcast. Finally, you can join Patreon, which gives you access to content like our podcasts and exclusive videos. Your support in any form is much appreciated. Until next time,
I'll see you at the table.